जय हिंद फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वी आर हियर इन आवर वार्तालाप सीरीज ऑफ कारगिल सीरीज ऑफ 2021। एंड टुडे वी आर ऑनर्ड टू हैव विद अस मेजर राकेश शर्मा। एंड हियर आई वुड जस्ट लाइक टू मेंशन दैट इन आवर वार्तालाप सेशन ही इज़ नॉट अ गेस्ट टू अस, ही इज़ वेरी मच अ फैमिली मेम्बर फॉर देश। So we are really honored to welcome Rakesh Sharma sir with us today, and we will hear from sir about his journey during the Kargil war. Major Rakesh Sharma has had his humble beginnings in a small village of Himachal Pradesh, Vilaspur. He joined the Indian Army in 1995, dedicating his prime youth in the service of the nation. He voluntarily served in insurgency prone sectors almost his entire army tenure. He actively planned and led various combat operations of varied team sizes at various levels. He actively participated in Operation Vijay in 1999. Besides earning Shaurya Chakra, he is a recipient of the military medals for Operation Meghdoot, Operation Vijay Star, Operation Vijay Medal, Operation Rakshak, and Operation Parakram. In 2005, he decided to venture out with the objective of learning and contributing to other segments. In the corporate sector, he had been associated with some reputed brands and also did some pioneering work in affordable housing for the less privileged. In 2013, Major Rakesh was awarded Shikhar Samman for social service by the Shikhar organization, a prominent national level NGO patronized by Virendra Sehwag. Further, in 2016, he was awarded Alwar Gaurav by another prominent NGO for his contribution to social development in the field of affordable housing. Now, to help the rural people in the fight against the pandemic, he, along with his friends, devised a strategy. The second wave of COVID-19 in our country has been devastating. In mid-April 2021, I and a few like-minded people realized that the virus is spreading to smaller towns and rural areas as well. We immediately took steps to address the need. The medical infrastructure as well as expertise in these areas is minimum. So, as said by Major Rakesh sir, and he is working on it. And even yesterday when I was talking to him about today's planning, sir was coming back to Uttarakhand after completing few of his work, and obviously he will again go to that sector for his service to the pandemic affected people. So today in the first segment of our Vartalab session, we will surely listen from him about his journey during the Kargil war. Sir.
Thank you so much. Of course, as you have enumerated and you briefed, I am very much part of this family. So first of all, Jai Hind to both of you, and Jai Hind to all the Indians and everybody out there listening to this conversation.
Jai Hind, sir.
Well, so as we talk about the Kargil operations and my experiences during those times, so when this started, so I was a young captain that time, and full of the sense of patriotism, and that sentiment where you can't expect the enemy to venture into your territory and capture the territory. So that sentiment was always there. Now when this all this started building up, and when the initial days, the first week of May, in fact it was in February, when the joint declaration between the two countries was signed, that Lahore agreement, that time itself the Pak Army had started certain activities. But as far as our understanding is concerned, it was in the beginning of May that we started, you know, coming to know about certain infiltration in those areas. Now, generally, what used to happen prior to that is that most of the infiltration used to happen in the valley and not in the Ladakh regions, because Ladakh regions are very arid regions, dry regions, huge snowfall. Most of the areas is not accessible during most of the times of the areas. So one was not expecting that to happen. So if you, even today, geographically, if you divide this entire region, Jammu and Kashmir, Ladakh region, then it is primarily divided in three big territories. So one is the Jammu region, which is divided by Pir Panjals, and the other side of the Pir Panjals is the Kashmir Valley, the Kashmir region, which is the most volatile area historically and even today. And then you have the upper Himalayas, which is the Ladakh and Leh regions. So that time when it started happening, I was on the extreme one corner of the valley, that is the Jammu region. And we, of course, being in the army, we used to hear the new things have started. But somehow, although I was from the day one, I was wanting to be in the war, but, you know, seeing this situation, that point of time where I got initially deployed, which was the other side of the, you know, far away from the battle zone. So I was really not expecting that I will get an opportunity. Although I was hoping like hell that, you know, when as a soldier, you always love that, you know, you get an opportunity. That's the worth of your being a soldier. That's what I feel personally. So one fine day, what happened that, you know, me and all my team. So we were a team of around 220 odd heads. So we were deployed, because army got deployed everywhere. So one was the active zone, which was the Kargil zone, let's call it Kargil zone. The other was the other areas where active operations were not happening, but army got deployed. So I got deployed in one of the areas, and we were ready that, you know, if something happens, then we are going to retaliate from this side. Nonetheless, what happened that, you know, one fine day, so I come from a regiment which has lots of technical equipment. So that time, you know, we had these Bofors guns and huge guns with lot of ancillary equipment to be carried along with, and the ammunition of the Bofors itself is something which is not very easy to handle. It's you know, numbers of trucks, and then you have the machinery to pick up the entire shells and the cargo ammunitions and all that. So it is all automatic, but it is time taking. Well, one fine day, luckily for me, what happened was that I got a so we used to have military phones those days, and I was connected through the to the local exchange, and there was a senior officer there who was the local commander. So I got a call from him, and he asked me generally what is happening and all those things. So I gave him a general report that we are ready and on all preparedness and all that. So he asked me that, do you want to move to war battle zone? So he didn't specifically use the word Kargil. So for a second I was shocked. So, you know, it just instantly, you know, like a electric came into my senses that, is he meaning that I'm going to Kargil? So I asked him, pardon, sir. He said, so he repeated again, do you want to move to war battle zone? So I said, sir, is it possible? He said, it's possible if you are ready to move by evening today. Otherwise, somebody else might go. So, of course, I said, sir, yeah, definitely. So now it was midday and we were getting ready for lunch and all. So I dropped the phone. Even then, it is not coming really into my entire being that I am going to Kargil. I was not ready to believe that. So then I called some of my senior members of the team, and then they gathered in front of my command post, and I asked them that, how many of you want to go to Kargil? So without hesitation, all hands went up like this state. I said, if you want to go to Kargil, then there is no time to have lunch, because we have to be ready, prepared to move by evening last light, as they in the Fauj it is called last light. So I said, you have to be ready to move by last light today. So there's no time left. Whatever we can pick up, we must, and we have to be ready by evening itself. So then we started with whatever hands we had, with whatever energy we had, whatever plans we had. So after 2 hours, I realized that, you know, this is not sufficient. It is not happening. With this speed and with these many hands, I will not be able to move by evening. So quickly I changed my plan, and I, you know, made a small party team of around 10 people, and I told them go to the villages and search for the helping hands. So these people, they went around the villages, and we got almost within next 40 odd minutes or maximum hour, we got almost 500 to 700 people who came to help us. No, and we gave all our food and our rations to them, and they helped us loading the entire, because this entire huge cells ammunition, it was all, you know, beneath the earth. So we had to dig it, we had to take it out and all that. So it was a huge activity. And there were some 30-40 vehicles along with the guns to be loaded with the ammunition and all. So by the grace of God, as I was scheduled to go to Kargil, so we could, you know, complete the entire activity, barring certain stores and all that, and we were ready to move. So this officer, senior officer, he came and he was shocked that, how did you manage all this? So I told him, sir, there was no choice. If I have to go to Kargil, I have to be ready. So then, you know, we started the move from there. And if you take it by road, then the Kargil was almost 400 plus kilometers from there. And with this whole lot of ammunition and all these things, it was quite a journey, in fact. So we traveled two nights. First night, in fact, we traveled, we reached Northern Command. We had a small tea break there. And then from there, we started again. And in the night, the second night, we reached Srinagar. Now, Srinagar was all chaos that point of time, because most of the people were culminating at Srinagar, the entire forces coming from all parts of the country going up, because till Srinagar the highway was good. After that, it is all very narrow, especially Srinagar, say when you go up and when you reach Sonamarg, then it is really treacherous. It's not easy. So Srinagar, we had a halt, and Srinagar, they were, you know, planning the move a bit more carefully. So there was a large, there's a long gestation or waiting period, which I could, view that it is going to take a lot of time from here, and I was not willing to wait. So what I did was I cleverly planned it in such a way that, you know, so they were allotting certain places to rest and all. So I told my boys that we are not going to go to those places. We'll rest under the vehicles only. So whatever dry rations we were carrying, we cooked the food in that open ground under the vehicles, and we had whatever we could. And incidentally, that very night, they said, one can move ahead. So I was the first one to reach there, and we left immediately. Now, that point of time, the initial phase of the Kargil operations had already started. So we had this unfortunate incident where, Captain Saurabh and his team were captured and all that. So what happened was that, and this is a lesson for me, before the real operation. So what happened was that there was a narrow bridge which I was trying to negotiate with the huge equipment I was carrying. And from the other side, there was a vehicle which was coming. So this vehicle is coming from Kargil side, going down, I am going up. So this vehicle is not ready to give any space to me. So I got annoyed and I got down. And I walked up to the vehicle. So there was a JCO who was there. He was looking quite demotivated. So, but I was in a hurry to reach Kargil, and I was full with energy and joy. So I started shouting on him. I said, don't you see that I am going to, you are coming down. Who's in hurry? Are you in hurry or am I in hurry? Should I be reaching the battle zone first, or you have to reach Srinagar first? So then, he saluted to me, and then he told me, he said, I'm carrying the bodies of the martyrs. So then I realized my mistake, and then I saw that there's a black flag, which generally in the army, when you have the bodies of the martyrs you carry. So these bodies were coming down actually that point of time. So I couldn't really fathom, I couldn't think of any answer to him, what to tell him. So I went behind and I, you know, jumped into the vehicle and I saw, and then I realized it was a big mistake. So I came out and I, you know, apologized to him. Sorry, Sapti, my mistake. I didn't see the black light on the vehicle, and I was in a hurry to reach Kargil, so I couldn't see it. And then I asked all my troops, all my people to give the way to the vehicle, and that's it. So that was the first experience before I could reach Kargil. So that was the first experience which demonstrated to me that what actually was happening there and what could be the situation.
The severity.
Yes. So, but see, this is where, you know, a soldier's mind tell a soldier, or when you speak to ourselves, that you are needed much more there. So that didn't actually demoralized or demoralize a big word, that didn't have any negative impact. That only impacted me positively, that I have to reach as early as possible and thereafter I have to be engaging with the enemy at the earliest minimum possible time. So that is the impact. Now, so we climbed Jojila Pass midnight, and we reached at the, I'll say the launching platform of the Kargil operations near Dras. In fact, it is about 20 odd kilometers short of Dras. So there also I realized that, you know, since some operations had already gone by and things were heated up, so there was not much of a system which was in place, because initial phase of war. So we all, if you know that, you know, war, initial phases of war is like a fog. It is quite misty. You don't, some information will come, there will be a lot of misinformation, everybody will be occupied, there won't be a clear intelligence what is happening, because it is the initial phases before you take control. It's like when you go out in the rains, so initially you are just trying to find out some place that where do I protect myself from the rain. So in that phase there is a lot of chaos, you don't understand things and like that. So then I realized that, you know, one has to be on his own here, because everybody is occupied and people are just doing what best they can do. So of course I was guided to a particular location, and this location now is just about 2 kilometers ahead of Tolodink. So then, because our equipment was very heavy, so we couldn't move during daytime, because the entire, all these heights were occupied, you know, the peaks, the Tiger Hill, then Three Pimples, all those top heights were already occupied by Pakistanis. So if you try to move during daytime, so you'll be bombarded. So we had a army drill, a typical army drill, where you have to switch off the lights, and even in the night you couldn't drive with the lights on, because they will hit the lights. So there's a army drill where you have to drive during the pitch dark without switching on the lights. The speed is very low. There is somebody who will indicate the mid of the road. This is the center of the road. So the driver is aligned to the center of the road, and that's how you go. So it took us a lot of time. So it actually took us 2 nights reaching at our place, because daytime we had to go for a hiding, and only night. So 2 nights we walked, we drove, and then finally we reached. And that point of time, the initial attacks phases was just going on. So we got a little bit of briefing and all those things. And then we realized that, you know, the severity of the operations and the heights which were there, these heights without a proper full-fledged military plan involving all the fighting forces, without that, it is not going to be possible for us to recapture those heights. Because if you see the initial phases of the battle, which were these days, by the way, in 99 June, initial June, and the operations when 6 June, I think 5th, 6th June was when we recaptured Thorolink, and after that the operations continued ahead. So this is where what happened was that the equipment which I was handling that point of time came in very handy, because it was not really very, and that is why we had initial operations, we had so many casualties. So initially, of course, Thorolink was the closest one, so we started bombarding that. I got there is a proper way where we operate and we neutralize the targets. One great ability which this equipment had is that it has the ability to shoot and scoot. So unlike the other artillery pieces which we had earlier, where the mobility was a restriction, this equipment was a self-propelled gun. So it had an auxiliary unit, it had all automated systems to fire. So we could change the locations very, very quickly. So, and the retaliation from the enemy side was very harsh and very quick. So if I fire from one location, within 5 minutes they'll fire back to that location. So if I don't move, I'm bombarded, burned there, I'm killed there itself. So what we did is that first location, so we bombarded certain points of Thorolink, and then we quickly changed, say 200, 300 meters. Like that, we used to operate and we used to change locations of the guns so that we are not surprised or we are not detected by their radars or by their, detecting equipments and all those things. Now, the problem was that, the entire height was so difficult that it was not easy to really pinpoint and, drop the shells in that particular zone or area. Because if you are out of that area, then you might be killing your own people. When you have the field forces going and attack, if you are not firing, then the enemy is pinning them down because they have no cover. So you have to give them cover and you have to fire. So that was a big challenge there, and that for that we had to really move a lot. So we moved, like I had in about month and a half of operations, I must have changed almost 40 to 50 different locations. Now, saying 40 to 50 here, sitting out here, it comes out very easy. Even changing one locations at those places where you don't find place for these guns to move, to park them, and thereafter to effectively fire, it's a very Herculean task. It's a very, very challenging task. Nonetheless, the good point was that, we started off there, and thereafter, as I said, initial phases of attack, there were casualties because the infantry just went in without, expecting that how firmly the enemy is embedded there, and to what extent they can really reach to those heights. Because like you people and many of other Indians who travel to those locations, so by just seeing those heights, it is so difficult to imagine that how could one can reach these heights. And when you have the entire enemy, the trained soldiers sitting on those heights firmly and pinning you down with their fire, so one can really imagine. I remember once after the entire operations got over, so some of Israelis, they came to my location and they spoke to me. So they said, probably it'll take us few years even to research that how could you people reach at those heights. So that was the severity and inclination of the entire scenario. Now, of course, it was in the initial times, even after when the war got over, people didn't realize that what job this equipment did for Kargil. It was only at a later period that India came to know that these Bofors guns were a deciding factor in the entire scheme of operations in the battle. So, in fact, at one point of time, we were short of ammunition, so we modified certain indigenous ammunition to be fired from the weapon. Otherwise, it is not very easy to even fire, you know, different kind of ammunitions. And besides that, we had then, you know, after a few days of operations, we got some very specialized ammunition from other countries, which was imported at a very, very quick scenario, in a very, very quick speed. It reached us there, and that ammunition was a very different kind of ammunition. It could fire very pinpoint. So then this was, so when 4th of July, I remember we recaptured the Tiger Hill. So from end of June and almost 3-4 days, we bombarded these Three Pimples, then this Tiger Hill and all those points so much that it actually changed the shape of the ground there. So that is where we enabled our infantrymen to get into a scenario, or in a grouped manner, in a planned manner, they could attack and they could recapture these posts. And of course, there were certain some of my own friends and my own brother in arms who had gone along with them and who guided us with the data and all that. But the fact remains that this could have been a long battle, rather than ending on, let's say, mid of July, had it not been for the bombardment by Air Force and the artillery. Both, in fact, Air Force also had, in the later phase of the battle, Air Force had a big role to play by dropping very, very, you know, precisely guided ammunition, as they said, they say. We had certain skirmishes with the, as we changed locations, there were certain skirmishes with the Northern Light Infantry soldiers and some of their infiltrators and all those things. But then we were prepared, because by that time, most of us, we had realized that it's not a small infiltration by a group of jihadists or, you know, some elements, but it is a pre-planned venture by the Pakistan Army, and they are, you know, intending to cut off the entire Leh region from the country. And also they were somehow intending that they'll get, after they capture the heights, so they will get a better bargaining table, negotiating table for Siachen. And of course, that point of time, they also had to give some fire to the militancy in the valley, because, you know, that was not also giving them very good results. Nonetheless, starting from the extreme right corner, the Jubbar Heights, and then the Kargil, the Kaksar region, then the Musco Valley, and all those things. So it took us, what do I say, around a month plus to recapture all those heights. Mostly 6-7 major heights, but the area was huge. So we got all that back in about a month plus time. The real operations were about a month plus. So that was it. And now, of course, in the thick of the war, you don't realize that, you know, what is happening. People hear it otherwise outside, but when you yourself in the war, then you don't know to come. You don't come to know most of the things. It only happens incidentally, you know, then we come to know that so-and-so has gone, or, you know, these many casualties in these operations. Of course, once it's over, then you have all the details. But when you yourself are in the, you're fighting in the thick of the battle, and you don't have time to even, you don't even think about having water or, you know, those kind of things. So those moments, the only thing which gets into your mind, in your body, in your heart, is that you have to, you know, take your territory back, you have to ensure sovereignty of the country, and you have to ensure the safety of the people of the country. That is the only thing which is there in the mind. And you don't even mind getting killed, to be honest. So, you know, it is for others to say, yes, family suffers. There's no doubt. Family has to pay a huge price. So, but that's what, you know, soldiering is all about. And luckily, you know, or with the grace of God and with the courage and the camaraderie which was visible during Kargil was exemplary, and we could, you know, get the entire thing back from Pakistanis, and then it's a history, we all know about that. So I was almost involved in all these operations, firing on Tiger Hill for 4 nights, 5 nights, then 3 temples, then of course, luckily me and Sanjay Saab, we are from same district, and of course at that point of time we were not aware of each other, and he was a young soldier at that time, just a Naik, a very young age, and his village is just about 10 kilometers from my village. So whenever we are in village, we meet occasionally. And so that's another, you know, point to cherish for me, that I have a PVC who's next to my village, and the entire valor and entire, you know, this, that kind of a sentiment which comes up.
Absolutely. You know,
so that's a matter of great pride for me as well.
Sir, while listening to you, I was just wondering, it's been 22 years of the war, and you all, those who fought the war, remember the geography of the area till today, like on your fingertips. So you were
every
telling
minute detail. Name.
Exactly. Every minute details you still remember, like all are on your fingertips. It's been 22 years.
Yeah, in fact, there are a lot of other small details. So the point here is that, see, this is embedded, this is ingrained inside you, because those were the moments which I'll say that only few luckiest ones in the country have lived and experienced those moments.
True.
So I was desperate to go to war. And I was feeling so frustrated that what am I doing sitting out here when the war started, as I was narrating with the initial days of war. I was so desperate, I was so frustrated that, you know, this is a lifetime opportunity where a soldier is, you know, getting to display his professionalism, his love for the country, his joys, and also, you know, how you face the enemy. So that's something very important. We all see in the movies and all that stuff, but when you really come across your enemy face to face, how do you act, how do you react, and what tactics do you employ? So this can be a huge discussion, but the logic for us to remember all these small locations, points, and, you know, the entire details so minutely, because for us it was, you know, life or death situation, number one. Number two,
absolutely,
we knew that this is where we have to ensure that we throw the enemy out. If we don't do it, then our being soldiers is no worth. So when you have that kind of a junoon sentiment inside your mind, it lives with you. It will always be there. It will only go once you go. Otherwise, to wo dimag mein hamesa rahega hi rahega. Aap kuch bhi kar lo life mein. उसके अलावा आप जॉब कर सकते हो, आप बिजनेस कर सकते हो, आप यू नो एक्टिव लाइफ की एक्टिविटीज हमारी सबकी अपनी अपनी है. वी आर रनिंग अराउंड, यू नो, फैमिली मैटर्स, सोशल रिलेशनशिप, बट दैट इज समथिंग वेरी यूनिक व्हेन यू आर इन अ वॉर एंड इज फेसिंग द एनिमी एंड दोज काइंड ऑफ सिचुएशंस, एंड यू आर ऑल्सो हैव टू इंश्योर दैट यू नो योर टीम इज प्रोटेक्टेड. दैट्स व्हाट दे कॉल कमराडरी. सो फर्स्ट, सो लाइक आई वांट टू शेयर विद यू पीपल दैट I had, when I had gone into the army, so I had quietly taken a vow in myself that till the time I am alive, I will not allow any of my team members to have a fatal, this thing, to be martyred. And this, more than anything else, this is my biggest achievement, because I've ensured that, you know, I protect my boys, I protect my team. So that is what it is all about. So I still cherish that. And, you know, this. So what happened was, when the war got over and we were all, it took us about 6-7 months more to really come out, because the planned entire mobilization was planned after that also. So I had these journalists, they would come, they will talk to us and all those things. So those days we won't even remember that who's coming, who's talking. For us, it was the only thing is that, okay, we have done our job, people are happy, country is safe. Now it's been these many years, 22 odd years, now the media and all those things. And in fact, Kargil was the first operation where people saw the war happening in their drawing rooms.
Absolutely.
So that time media was also just opening up. And for us, it was nothing like that. So we were just completely engrossed in our operations and throwing the enemy out. And then I remember last phase of the operations, these people were not even willing to take the bodies of their own soldiers. So we got involved in, you know, we called Kargil say, we called people to do their last rituals.
We helped doing their last rituals
when they refused to accept that, you know, their soldiers were involved, the Northern Light Infantry was involved. So these are very unique experiences in life, and one has to feel, I'll always thank Almighty that I got the, you know, finally Almighty listened to me, and 400 odd kilometers covering the distance I could reach Kargil. So I have to only thank the Almighty for that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So the way you narrated, you took us 22 years back, you could actually visualize how things were happening. So want to share with our viewers also a glimpse of it, sir. One second.
Yes, sir.
Sound is not coming, Audrija.
Sound is not coming. One second. Maybe the sound will be a little low.
Yes, sound is low in this. This is a very old video cassette.
For our viewers, this is actually live from Kargil War.
So this location is just about 1 kilometer from the memorial towards Kargil.
Okay, and just now that mountain we saw, what is that, sir?
So that is the extreme right of the Torolink.
Okay.
Extreme right. Yeah, lovely memories.